Good morning and welcome to Journey Church. We are so excited to be with you. I am so excited that today is Communion Sunday. So before we go into worship, feel free to go ahead and look around your house and grab what you need to participate in Communion today.
Falls and won't prevail, 'cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. 'Cause I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. 'Cause I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, 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 oh. Yeah. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will win. Oh, I'm not backing down from any giant. Yeah, 'cause I know how this story is. Yes, I know.
For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, we sing hallelujah.
Well, we had a great time with worship today. I want to just give you guys two announcements that are really important to us today. The first one is that the pastoral care update form is an opportunity for us to pastor you, to connect with you, and it also serves as a prayer request form. You can head to our website, myjourney.church, to go ahead and fill it out. If you're big on our social media platform, you can always go to the link in bio in our Instagram to fill out the pastoral care form. And this is an opportunity for us to pray with you and pray for you. Did you also know that this is a great opportunity for you to connect with us? We have multiple ways that you can connect with us, but one of the big ways is that we want you guys to think about what's happening next with small groups. If you've been desiring to lead a small group, listen, we know that with Zoom and having that exhaustion of all the things happening with lockdown and quarantine and all the things that we have endured, this is a time that we need to be connecting with one another. So if you're interested in leading a small group, please go ahead to our website, myjourney.church/small groups, and complete a form to say that you would like to lead a group, or you can email me, gifty@myjourney.church. We believe in community and we believe in connecting to one another. We can't do life by ourselves. Lastly, I want to encourage you to give. If this is your very first time giving, there's multiple ways that you can give. You can text to give, you can give via the Tithely app, or even through our website. We are so excited that we have a church that's generous, that allows us, even in a pandemic, to grow and to thrive. So God bless you and thank you for your giving.
Hi, I'm Brianne Locke. I'm a member of Journey Church and a social worker here in Calgary. Did you know Calgary police respond to a domestic conflict every 30 minutes? Alberta has one of the highest rates of domestic violence in Canada, with Calgary being no exception. In 2017, Calgary police responded to 18,500 domestic conflict calls. That's about 2 domestic calls every hour, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. And in 2018, that number was higher, with a 13% increase from the year before. Each year in Canada, it is estimated that up to 362,000 children witness or experience family violence. Do you ever hear about family violence and think, thank goodness that issue is not something that I need to worry about? If you've had this thought, I want you to know the odds are that likely you do know someone who's being directly affected by domestic violence in our city. With the recent pandemic, those domestic violence numbers are going up due to pressures, stress, job loss, and substance abuse being on the rise as well. Domestic violence spans across all cultures, all communities, all socioeconomic statuses, and all religions. And Calgary is the same. In my work as a social worker, I have worked with many women who are fleeing domestic violence. And usually when they leave is the most dangerous time for them. One woman specifically that I did work with, she was an immigrant from another country, didn't know anybody in Canada, and had left her home and was in a shelter. She had no form of communication and no phone, and her husband would not provide one. As I did my work with her, one of the startling realizations I came to is that there are no agencies in Calgary, not even Calgary Police, that can give out cell phones to women or have the resources of cell phones for women. And so in my work with her, I had to do a lot of work to try to get her some way of calling for help if she was in danger. And so this year, Journey Church is going to be collecting cell phones starting on January 10th that we can give out to women who are fleeing domestic violence so that they have a way to call for help if they are in danger. The cell phone does not need a SIM card in order to be able to call 911 or call for help. So please partner with us, bring your used cell phone starting January 10th and help us help women who are fleeing domestic violence.
Good morning, church. We have the awesome opportunity to take communion together and this morning. So if you are sitting on your living room couch and you've forgotten that we're having communion today, I'd just encourage you maybe run out there to the kitchen and grab some bread and a little bit of juice or whatever you have in your cupboard right now. I know this is not like how we normally take communion. Obviously, in regular world, we really value taking communion together, but we do think there's something so important about taking the sacraments, the bread that represents Jesus's body and the juice or wine or whatever you're having this morning that represents the blood of Jesus. We know that, that's a very important part of our faith, and so we're going to virtually have communion together. This week, as I was studying just about the life of Jesus, I came across John chapter 17, where Jesus is praying the last prayer that he would pray out loud. And this happens, John's gospel doesn't talk to us about the Last Supper, but we can fit in the narrative that this happened just before or after the Last Supper. So Jesus is praying this very, it's his very last prayer before he's crucified. And you can imagine that this is a heavy prayer, and he is praying in the middle of a great crisis. And as I was reading John chapter 17, I thought about how that so aptly, his prayer so aptly sort of resonates with the situation many of us find ourselves in today, that we're in difficult days. And yet I think the words of Jesus' prayer are so important for us to take in to our hearts this morning. I would encourage you, we're not going to read it this morning, but I would encourage you maybe after church is over that you would read John chapter 17, the prayer of Jesus, the last prayer of Jesus with your family. But in that prayer, let me just say this, Jesus really prays that the body of Christ would have unity. He prays this very overtly, that, all of God's people would act in unity. And really, when it comes to the Last Supper, this is really what it's about, that we would remember Jesus, not as individuals, but as a community in unity. And then when we turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, this is the quintessential communion scripture that we often read. The first half, starting at verse 17, talks about this. The Apostle Paul says, listen, the most important thing when you're taking communion is not that you're so spiritual or that you're wearing the right clothes or that you have the right words to say. It's that you would be unified, that you would think of one another. And I can think of nothing more important than in this day, when we're in difficult days, that we would really lean into the idea of unity amongst each other. You know, the enemy, when we're in a hard spot, I mean, this is just true of all of us, you know, when you're a little bit thin, the first thing that happens is you get annoyed with people, you snap at people, or some of you go inside yourselves and you don't talk at all. And the first thing to go is our unity. We know this in our families. When you're in a hard spot, the first thing that goes is everybody starts fighting. And the Apostle Paul talks about this before communion. He said, listen, the most important thing is that you would keep unity as we remember Jesus. And so this morning, as you hold up your whatever you're using, your cracker or bread and juice, I just want to pray over us as a community. I want to pray for your families, that you would sense the unity of Jesus in this time. I'm praying for your workplaces, that you would sense unity in those places. And I'm praying for us as a community, Journey Church, that we would sense the unity of Jesus, that we would be able to say that these are hard times, but we are all in this together, pulling for each other, rooting for one another. Apostle Paul said this, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Can we take the cracker or the bread and just remember Jesus? In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup in the new covenant is in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's just take that juice together. So Jesus, we thank you in this place that your arm is not too short, that you are wherever we are. And God, I thank you as we gather virtually this morning that you are in our midst. Father, I pray that you would speak to people very clearly today. Would you show us, God, where we've gone off path or where we've gone astray? I pray in Jesus' name that you would be, we would sense your presence in a very real and tangible way. And God, I'm praying for every household today that they would sense the unity of the Spirit. I'm praying for our congregation, praying for Journey Church this morning, that God, as this pandemic continues to drag on, that you would not cause us to be pulled apart, but actually, God, that we would come back stronger together. And just maybe in this moment, you might just feel a little prompt from the Holy Spirit to give somebody a call. Maybe it's somebody who normally sits by your seat in church on Sunday, or somebody you've been in a small group with before. Can I just encourage you that in the spirit of communion, that you would just reach out and call them today. And let's continue to be a unified body of believers that push back on darkness and begin to see what God is going to do in our city and our nation.
Hey, everybody. Just wanted to say a great big welcome to Church Online, and so thankful for your faithfulness during this unique season of life. 2020 is gone. We're in 2021, and we're in now 14 days of prayer as a church, and I'm so happy to be sharing with you another message in this, can we call it a mini-series on prayer. Last week, we looked at James 5, that talks about the prayer of faith. And I just loved what James said about prayer in verse 13, where he says, "Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray." Well, what's funny to me is that during this history-making season of life, the question James posed many years ago that is so relevant to us today, is anyone in trouble? Well, I think a resounding yes, every one of us. We're all faced with this global health crisis and doing our best. But you know, the truth is our best just isn't good enough. And we need prayer. So today I want to ask you, what are you praying for? And that is the title of this message today. What are you praying for? Especially in a time where we are doing our best to stay physically distant, yet isn't it funny that even though we are distant physically, we can feel closer than ever through the Holy Spirit? It's an incredible thing. I'm so thankful for the Spirit of God and that we could just feel that in our time, even in our time of communion today. Let me just say, that's why more than ever, we need to lean into community. We need to lean into small groups, as you'll hear about that today, because we're so much better together. You know, many of you are facing big challenges in life, and I don't know what they are, but I want you to know, my God knows, your God knows, and He wants you to reach out to Him today. Some of you are saying, "Jesus, I need a big miracle today. Like, if I don't get a miracle, things are going to go bad really quick." I want to share with you in Scripture, in Psalm, that serves as our anchor today. Psalm 77 says this, "Your ways, God, are holy. What God is as great as our God? You are the God who performs miracles. You display your power among the people," Psalm 77, 13 and 14. That's what we're praying, that God would display His power. He would display His power among the people during this COVID-19 reality, that God would display His power over single moms, over single dads, and over university, high school, and elementary students that are trying their best to do their academics online in their living room. God, display your power over us as a church. Display your power over us together. That's our prayer. What's your prayer today? You know, what miracles are you believing God for? You know, the word miracle has been defined for us. Actually, Merriam-Webster defines it this way. A miracle is an extraordinary event manifesting divine intervention in human affairs. Jesus did just that. Jesus performed many miracles that are recorded in Scripture. And I want us to look at the miracle of the blind beggar. And we're going to look at Luke's gospel. But in Mark's gospel, it talks about the blind beggar as Bartimaeus. And so we're going to read that today. And if you don't have a Bible, pull out your Bible. Now's the time to do it. Go to the chat room and you'll see a Bible there for you. I want to read it from the Gospel of Luke today. Such a great account of what prayer can do. What are you praying for today? Let me ask you that again. So verse 35 is, "As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard the crowd going by, he asked what was happening. No, he couldn't see, but he could hear. And we know that the scene is the prelude to the Easter story, and it's the passion of the Christ, and this is kind of what's happening. That's the scene, that's the set that's taking on here. So there's a lot of things that are going on here. Verse 37 says, they told him, Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. He's called out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Those who led the way rebuked him and told him to be quiet. Have you ever been around someone who just has a really loud voice and doesn't know how to regulate or change the volume of their voice? They're loud and they should be quiet, or they're quiet when they should speak up. Well, this man is speaking very loudly. In fact, the scripture says, but he shouted all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. Verse 40, Jesus stopped and ordered the man to be brought to him. When he came near, Jesus asked him, what do you want me to do for you? I love this scripture because I believe that's exactly what Jesus is asking you today. What are you praying for? What do you want me to do for you today? That's what God is saying to us. There's so much hope and so much excitement in those words that I believe this is what God is asking all of us today. I don't know, maybe you felt a bit forgotten and all alone, and maybe you feel by the side of the road like this blind beggar. You don't know, you know, what's going to go on with the future holds. You don't know what's in store for you next. You feel like you can't see ahead. Jesus looks at this man, and he looks at you, and he looks at me today, and he says, what do you want for me to do for you? Hear this today. Maybe you're filled with fear, and you're filled with worry. Jesus comes to you today. What do you want me to do for you? Lord, he says, I want to see. He replies, Jesus said to him, receive your sight, your faith has healed you. I'm praying today that you would have faith to believe for whatever you're asking Jesus for. There may be total darkness in your life today, but Jesus is total light. The prayers that you've been praying in the total darkness would meet the light of Jesus so that you would experience some answered prayers and you would not give up today. Let's look at verse 43. It says, immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. When all the people saw it, they also praised God. Incredible story. I love this story because I think we can all relate to the feeling of being lost sometimes and maybe feeling blind and have difficulty seeing the next step beyond where we are today. And if you're taking some notes today, here's a few things I want you to write down that maybe you can learn that will help all of us in receiving our sight. First thing is that we have a problem. We have a vision problem, just like this beggar here. We're not able to see. Once we had sight, but something has happened and now we are without vision. You see, when you're blind, you don't even know if it's light or dark. You have no sight. And maybe that's exactly what you're feeling. You can't get your bearings on your future. You can't get your bearings on your job or your family. You just feel totally blind. Paul talks about faith. He says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Romans 10:17. So we have a problem, like this blind beggar that we read about. The next thing that we need to understand today is that we must, secondly, activate our faith in prayer. You know, the blind man could not see, but he could hear what was going on. So in order for you to produce results, don't stop praying. Just because you cannot see the results of your prayers, this is not the time to quit. the blind man could not physically see, but he had faith to believe that what he could not see could be seen by faith. You know, this is not a time for the coronavirus to silence us. This is not a time for fear and anxiety to silence us. This is a time for us as a family, corporately, together, to activate our faith in prayer. You know, the blind beggar, he had a problem. He had a faith to believe. He prayed. And then, third thing is, he had a shout of praise. You know, begin your praise. The blind man could not see, but he was able to hear and shout. And when he finds out that it was Jesus, he shouts to Jesus, hey, Jesus, Jesus. And those around him are like shushing him, if that's even a word. Shushing, shh, it's Jesus. What's your problem? You know, you're too loud. You're so emotional. Don't you know better than that? That's not how you do it. Come on, man. Watch this. He didn't let all the naysayers, he didn't let all the negative people silence his shout. No, 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 no. He didn't let all his problems, he didn't let all of his lack determine his shout. Have you ever, you know, had anyone shush you? Like, no way. You just got all the louder. Jesus, Jesus, like, have mercy on me. You ever had those times when I've had some moments where I'm so aware of what Jesus is doing in my life that I just can't help myself, but I have to shout. I remember there's moments and times I'm driving and I have no words, but Jesus is the only word that comes to mind. Just shouting his name, Jesus. And then I start singing, you know, old hymns that I can remember because I can't remember the lyrics to the new songs. I'm getting a bit old. Anyway, I'm shouting and I'm screaming at the tops of my lungs, and I can relate to this story. And it seems like the crowds maybe around you are trying to take away your joy. They're shushing you. Listen, you don't know my struggles. I don't know your struggles. You don't know what I've come out of. Don't let anyone shush you. Literally, his shout opened up a pathway to the Savior of the world, Jesus. Today, don't let panic, don't let anxiety or the fear or all the changes that are taking place or not being able to see the future, don't let that get your praise. Sometimes you need to praise him, not for what you don't have, but what you do have. Come on, take some time. Remember what he's done for you and be thankful for that. What we all need to remember is that Jesus is always available for you. Regardless of how busy or how crazy your life looks right now, Jesus is passing by. And even though it doesn't look good, guess what? Jesus takes time for you and for me. I think about that. I think, are you kidding me? The Savior of the world? Like, surely he's got other more important things to do than a poor old beggar than like me and my troubles. That's how I've seen it in the past. And seriously, God, you have time for me and my issues? I felt like that before. Have you ever felt like that? Like your life hasn't been perfect. In fact, very far from perfect. But how is it that a God would stop for a person like me? Well, he does. It doesn't make sense. But here's the good news. He loves you anyway. He stops for you, and he takes the time for you today, and he takes the time for me, and all you need to do is call out to him. Jesus! Fourth thing is, wait for your answer, your miracle. Here's the thing. After he received his miracle, he praised God, and what happens? It says, when all the people saw it, they also praised God. You see, answered prayer, your miracle, will not only impact and change your life, it will change and impact the lives of those around you. You catch that? It's going to impact people around you. So don't think praying for a miracle is a selfish thing. No, no, no. It can be a sign to others to see the glory of our God and his incredible miracle-working power. You know, some years ago, I can remember Jess and I were pastoring in the inner city of Toronto, and almost daily we would see someone begging with a cup. And they'd shake it and ask for something and spare change, sir, spare change. And it's all around you, and you see it here in big cities. And on one occasion, I placed something in the cup, and I can remember the gentleman with such appreciation say, "Thank you, sir. God bless you." And he kept shaking his cup. He kept walking around and just kind of wandering around. And he didn't have much, but he had a cup. And he could see and he could hear. And blind Bartimaeus didn't have much, but Jesus came out of the cup of his mercy, out of the cup of his miracles, out of the cup of his grace. And James put a miracle, and Jesus puts a miracle into his cup and changed his whole life. Listen, as I pray for you today, I feel like, you know, like we've got our cup of emotions. We've got our cup of lack. We've got a cup of uncertainty. You know, what am I going to do? But Jesus comes along for those of you who feel like your cup is empty. Jesus comes to fill it today. I want to pray for you. Let's pray together. Lord, I pray for everyone that feels that they are stumbling, that feels empty and not sure what to do next. I pray that God, you would fill their empty cup right now. What are you praying for? You know, there's no greater miracle than the gift of salvation. It's a free gift given to those who call upon the name of Jesus. Maybe you're feeling blind today. You have pain. You have sin. You have lots of hurt. Jesus wants to restore your life today and give you his grace. If you want to receive Jesus in your life right now, pray this simple prayer with me. Dear Jesus, I need you. I need you right now. I ask you to come into my life. Take all my weaknesses. Take all of my pain. Take all of my hurt. Take all of my brokenness. And I'm calling on your name. I'm asking you to fill me with your grace. Fill me with your love. I ask you to forgive me of my sin. And I receive the gift of salvation, of life that is in you, Lord Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. Hey, listen, if you have said that prayer today, God has sent his son Jesus to live in your life. His Holy Spirit is with you. And in this moment, he's beginning a new work in your life. And maybe you're in home and you're feeling isolated. You're feeling like this world is just kind of been crazy and you just feel empty. Let me remind you today that Jesus wants to fill your cup to overflowing. He wants to pour in his grace. He wants to pour in his love. He wants to give you life and life more abundantly. Just reach out to him today. He's there for you. He is available to you today. Thanks for connecting with us today. If you need someone to pray with you, we'd love to do that. God bless you. Have an amazing week.
Church, we had a great time with you this morning. So thank you for joining in. If this is your first time, we want to connect with you. So send us an email, connect@myjourney.church. We want to get to know you and your family. Also, if you've made a first-time decision to follow Jesus, we are so excited for that. There is a button that you can click that's saying that you have made a decision for the first time, and we will be sending you a now what, next steps information. Church, we love you. We care for you. We're so excited to be able to gather, even if it's virtually. If you require prayer, you can click the live prayer button, and our hosts are ready and willing to pray for you. Have a great afternoon and enjoy the rest of your day, church. And thank you so much for tuning in daily to our daily devotionals for our fasting and prayer.